You guys learn anything?
Nope.
Did Mario grant any sense? Did he match your intuition? He did.
Not first.
Not first, really? So, a random intercept only model has no serial process, right? So you'd expect that one looking like this, right? A random intercept and random slope problem would have a serial process. You'd expect that to be coming up. There is some small degree of measurement in this problem. I just simulated it through. You may be referring to this here. So part of that you have to realize is coming from the fact that there is limited kind of being pulled to some degree by the smoother, and it's pretty highly influenced by the smoother. The other thing is that the random slope model, while it does induce a time-dependent correlation structure, it doesn't induce it under the assumptions of the variogram. And what I mean by that is the variogram has some particular assumptions on that row of u term for the serial process. And the assumptions were that as u approached zero, rho approached one, and as u approached infinity, rho of u approached zero. And so it doesn't quite follow that same thing. So really, you're a little bit outside of the framework of the derivation of the empirical variogram. But you can see the serial process picking up, and then you got to be kind of careful of what happens over here where you get one of the amounts of food on that process. When you've got kind of truly a serial, yes, question. When you've got truly a serial process, this is kind of like what you guys have been seeing, a pretty strong serial process over here. You can see that in cases like this, again, where if I break my smoother, and I didn't really train these smoothers, I just kind of fit in the plastic. Not just ones here. I'll get influence again, kind of coming where I have a little amount of data, but you can see that this kind of comes up quickly and then tapers off pretty fast, which is what you really see when you look at the empirical covariance and you can start tapering off around 6. So. So interestingly, you know, I don't know if it has a direct translation to be honest. Again, because the empirical variogram doesn't really target a random slope and intercept process. So I can't sit and point to you and say this particular part of the curve is going to indicate a negative correlation between the random slope and intercepts. I couldn't really do that. I mean, all I can tell you is that it's invoking to say there is a serial process that's changing as a function of time. But you kind of lose the fact that, again, you get overwhelmed if you don't really pick up the random intercepts over in these situations. Okay. So I wish I had a better answer for you. But again, it was never developed under that full framework, right? I mean, we never kind of, the way it was developed was by saying, let's think about gamma, you've got a random intercept, but then you got the serial process with, again, the constraints that I just talked about, plus some measurement error term. So it was never under a concept of saying a random intercept and a random slope. But I wanted you guys to look at it outside of that quote unquote parametric type of framework to see what the visualizations are. And then finally, you've got, you know, independent data. That's what you would hope to see, right? So things basically align up there at the total variations. Oh. So what about, that problem extremely enlightening and very, very useful, I have to be honest with you. So it's a classic way of saying if you're just smart about parameterizing a model and statistics, you can gain back a ton of efficiency. Okay. And we've been doing that. I mean, that's what I've been kind of talking about all along, right? And saying, look, if you model the covariance structure reasonably well, you can gain back efficiency. You might be able to guarantee consistency and unbiasedness in other settings, but just doing kind of some simple tricks on the model can get you back. In other words, buy you information for free, which is rare in modeling. Okay. So this particular problem is a very simple problem, and I picked the pole and office hour, but I'll take it again here. If I were to come in here and give you guys, before you even done this problem, give you guys data where I said, look, here's a pre-measurement on people, here's a post-measurement on people, tell me what the effective treatment is. I'm guessing 90% of you, probably 100% would have done what it's data. A pair of T-tests, right? I mean, that's what you guys, I mean, that's the natural thing to do, right? Take post minus pre, I've got now a univariate response, go ahead and look at the difference in the means of that univariate response, plot treatment group. Okay, so that's ultimately actually what this first model came up to be. Actually, your estimator there comes up to be the pair t-test, the numerator of the pair t-test. That is exactly what it is. It just broke down to being the good old within subject difference, take the average of that, and then subtract the good old within subject difference from the placebo arm or the control arm, take the average of that. Okay. But again, realizing you can use some things to your advantage, you could say, ah, but I've got this setting where I know for a fact that the expectation of the pre-measurement in the control is the same as the expectation of the pre-measurement in the treated arm. And you know, this is really coming to my general philosophy on statistics, which is 90% of the impact of statistics can come from design. About designing a study well, that's a huge part of the problem, okay? So this is a design element, right? So by randomization, I can guarantee this. So now, if I do that, then I know that beta 1 in the previous setup is actually equal to 0. So then I can say, okay, well, I can throw that out of the model. It's not going to change anything. The interpretation of gamma remains the same. I'll be interested to see how you guys went about finding the maximum likelihood estimate for gamma. But I gave the problem that I wanted you guys to do it while I was working on the Rimmel derivation. Because an easy way to do this is to think about marginal likelihood. You could take the bivariate PDF and you can decompose it. You could say, okay, I'll look at the PDF for the post-measurement conditional upon the pre-measurement times the PDF for the pre-measurement. If you do that, you realize very, very quickly that the distribution of the pre-measurement does not depend upon gamma. So you can, it factors away. And then the conditional, well, just working with normals, the conditional distribution of the post given the pre, the mean of that guy just looks like this. Oh, that's kind of nice for us. Because here's our gamma, that's what we're scientifically interested in. But really, what is this thing that's sitting here? The way I have this thing specified, this is an OLS model. It's almost stochastic. And this is my linear mean. And sigma 1 is equal to sigma 0 in the problem. That thing is equal to 1. So really, the coefficient that's going to sit on the post measurement is really just my estimate from the OLS model that's going to come into that thing. And this guy here, the maximum likelihood estimate for it is just going to be the OLS mean. So I wrote that down for you guys, just the sum of the squared differences means there. And what you will end up seeing in that problem then is that you end up getting something that looks like this guy here, right? Where now my estimator has the form post-measurement minus not just pre-measurement, which was what the paired sample t-test was, but some weight basically that's put on that pre-measurement. And how much I want to weight that is going to be a function of the correlation. Is this kind of sounding familiar to what we've been doing all along? That's the weighting by the correlation within the cluster. Trying to gain back efficiency, that's what's going on here. And if you do that, you end up getting the following variance for that guy. And I just simply said, hey, look, you can look at this problem as just a general class of estimators now. They all have a form that looks like so, where you've got this alpha term in there. You've seen it. One derivation, the paired sample, two sample t-test, where you take alpha equal to be 1. You've seen another one where you constrain upon the means being 0, which gives rise to a linear regression model. This becomes rho, now the correlation between the pre and the post. Another obvious choice, I would say, is what some people actually do in these settings, not very wise, but take alpha to be 0 and just analyze the post. I mean, again, it's a valid estimate of the treatment effect. It will tell you what the difference between treatment groups are in the mean response, but it's throwing away any information you might have gained on the pre-measurement. And the whole reason of doing the pre-measurement is to lose some information back. But the key thing for you guys then is to realize that how these variances compare. And I think that these are some telling signs, right? One says, if you go and only use the post measurements, you're gonna do worse in terms of your estimate of the treatment effect as long as rho is greater than a half. If rho is greater than a half, then you're gonna gain information off of that pre-measurement because it's like a precision variable. So now you're reducing down that variance in the response. And even better than that though, you just go and say, okay, well, if I consider any estimator of this form, and I just want to optimize, well, what's the value of alpha that optimizes that? In other words, minimizes the total variance? So you're right there at alpha equal to rho. That's the best you're going to do. Right? So that's telling you now that the best you're going to do is to condition upon the baseline means in that model and get an estimator of this form. Well, in practice, normally what we do then is we don't go with the full GLM model that's sitting up here where I model both responses. You simply say, what I'll do is I'm just going to take the post-measurement and I'll regress it on treatment, and I'll regress it on the pre-measurement. That's what we generally do on practice, and we get the same estimate. So in practice, so up here, the way I have to set it up is as a repeated measures, right? I've got Y0 as a response, and I've got Y1 as a response. I'm modeling an indicator of whether it was the pre or the post measurement and then the treatment interaction. In practice, what I've shown here is the MLE that would stem from this model is actually equivalent to just regressing the post measurement on the treatment and on the pre measurement. So that's the way we normally would go about fitting that model. You could do it both ways. You normally would go about fitting just regressing the post measurement on the pre.
Could it maybe just regress the difference?
What's that now?
Like the difference, just like look at the differences between the post and pre.
And regress that on treatment?
Yeah.
And that gets you back to which estimator you've actually looked at?
First one.
The first one, which is inefficient relative to that one. Why would you do it, right? You're estimating the same thing. That's the paired sample, two-sample t-testing. Okay. So, again, if you read the literature, you'll see people that just take post, people that take the difference. This one actually is always going to be as efficient as using the post. There's not even a one-half. If it's less than one-half for your variance, then you come out equal to the post. You can actually look at that. So now, if you want to see, I just kind of quickly typed up a quick simulation study. So you can kind of see it in practice, right? So let's take, this is just a quick example where I take the correlation between the pre and post measurements to say be 0.6. Okay? A modest correlation, something you might see in practice. And so sigma squared here on both is just equal to 1. So I'm just going to generate data where I've got treatment here, and the treatment effect is going to be 3, okay? So that's the difference between the means treated versus control. So if I simulate up those data, I can fit the models in a few different ways. If I wanted gamma 1 hat, I could do that with the GE model using just an exchangeable correlation matrix, right? That was what you guys had in the first model. Right now, model the main effect for treatment, the main effect for the indicator of a post measurement and interaction. If I do that, you'll see that I get back a consistent estimate of the treatment effect. That's 3. So I generated the data. And I've got both my naive and robust standard errors are going to be basically the same as because under the correct model, it's an exchangeable model, it's just two measurements that's there. That shouldn't surprise us. And you can see that the correlation for the working correlations around 1.6. That's what I simulated. So this would be, this is exactly equivalent now to the estimate that would come out of the paired two-sample t-test. Okay. You guys derived that. I could then fit gamma hat 2 where I say, no, what I want to do is I want to ignore the main effect for treatment at the pre-measurement, so I pull that out of the model. So I'm just explicitly modeling now the interaction between post and treatment and then just the main effect for post. And if I do that, then you see I get, again, a consistent estimate and an unbiased, truly estimate of the treatment effect. It's slightly different, and it's going to be slightly different. They're different estimators, but they both should be very close to 3, which is the truth. Notice now the standard error, though. It's smaller. And you got to think about things relatively. That standard error dropped by about 20%. So now, the alternative way of fitting those two models, this is exactly what you just now said, RC, right? Is I could take the difference post minus pre and just regress it on human data. Again, that's the two sample t-test. And then I could do what I did from the marginal likelihood where I said, no, really you could also just think about the, called the ANCOLA model, that's your gamma and two, as being post, regress now on treatment, and then the pre-measure. So if I do those, we get essentially the exact same answers. Come back out of these guys. It's in there. And then it's interesting to then look at how did the theoretical variances compare? Because this is really the utility of what you're doing. So theoretically, you guys wrote them down. The first variance for gamma hat 1 looked like 4 times sigma squared times 1 minus rho divided by m. And then for gamma hat 2, it looked like 2 times sigma squared times 1 minus Sasha, rho squared, right? I accidentally dropped a rho there when I was talking to these guys. Rho squared. So if you look at the relative efficiency between those things, it's 1.25. So again, you have to think relatively. So what does that mean when I say the relative efficiency is 1.25 between those two models? Like in real world, like you explain what the impact of that is. What does that mean?
Well, maybe the impact is that the confidence interval.
It is, but that's there's even a more real world statement that will really hit.
Yes. You get 1.25 worth of observation information.
Exactly. It's like by just changing the model and flipping pre to a predictor and estimating the correlation between those things, it's like I increased my sample size by 25%.
Wah.
I mean, that's huge. Right? That is huge. Just by flipping this thing over. I don't know if you guys can appreciate that, but again, I work on studies where it's like $70,000 a person for an observation.
Mm-hmm.
That's not a joke. You can increase your sample size by 25% by just changing your model. That's huge. Okay. All right. So, and then you can look at that relative to the simulated data. That should hopefully agree with what we have, so I'm just taking out the estimated variances. I haven't actually looked at this, but yeah, there you go. So it's 1.23 on the same data, right? And so again, you kind of see it working. Okay.
So what are clues for us in practice, right, that we can use in this? Is it when we have correlation?
Exactly. So it follows the exact same theme, to be honest, Marty, that I've been telling you all along, which is first get a consistent estimator. Make sure we're always there, right? I'm always estimating the same treatment effect. I'm not screwing that up. I don't want to do that. But then after that, if I've got correlation in my data, now smart guy, it's really what you're doing. You're waiting. You're waiting by the correlation. And so get a good estimate of what the correlation is. And then you use that estimate as you're going throughout the weeks. So anytime you're in a non-IID setting, that's what you want to start being thinking.
So just to clarify, so we don't know the correlation in advance, right?
No.
So to apply it in practice, to pick the optimal weight, we need to first estimate it on a separate set or what?
No, I'll claim not. In fact, that's why I had you do this part of the problem. Why I had you do this problem. Because the optimal weight is always the correlation. So you just need a consistent estimate of the correlation. Linear regression will get that for me every time. Every time. I mean, there's not even a question. The ANCOVA model is going to target that weight, that row weight, by regressing post on pre. So it's not even a question of me knowing. Now, you could, if you were doing the paired t-test, and your correlation is actually less than 0.5, this is something they don't teach you in stat. That's 7, so it's kind of hard to do. But if your correlation is less than 0.5, and you do the paired t-test, you actually lose efficiency relative to just modeling the responses. So now you're kind of throwing away data. Okay. And so, by incorporating that in. But that does not happen with the ANCOVA model, where you weight by row, because that kind of is accounting for the fact that the correlation is less than 0.5. It's always as good as just using the post, and oftentimes much better when rho is bigger than 0.5. It's much better in terms of variance. So it looks like a very simple problem, but it has massive impacts. And again, the point of the last part of this, I'm really, you know, Hina didn't like this because I am asking for you guys to make a huge leap. But the idea is to say, take the two sample analogy, and now you take it to repeated measures across everything. It's what we've been doing in the general linear model. It says estimate the correlation structure and weight those estimates by the correlation structure. Okay? That's what I'm doing when I have the GEE model for gamma hat 2. I'm just using the working correlation structure of 0.6 as an estimate to weight. All right. Any more questions on that? So, you guys want to talk about the midterm a little bit? Midterm tomorrow. You'll be proud of me. I have written the midterm. Save all night writing the midterm. Midterm's fun. So I can give you real logistics on the midterm. What's the over-under on the number of problems?
It's not the number of problems, it's the number of parts. Is it like A through Z? Did you have to start using Greek letters?
I would say you're thinking big picture. I spent quite a bit of time in this class talking about quality of life data estimates. Really what that did was it gave rise to a derivation of the asymptotic distribution. by that is, what is the relative performance of correctly specifying the likelihood to writing down the MLE and obtaining that estimator versus misspecifying the likelihood and what its operating characteristics are? In other words, what its mean variance are. For the variance in the randomly specified model. I mean, the beauty of, well, all this stuff is, look, the central limit theorem says that these estimators are basically going off to norm, right? So you gotta worry about the mean, the outcome estimate, and you gotta worry about the variance. What is the variance of that thing in order to draw it in first time? So that's about as easy as it's ever gonna get in statistics, okay? You got two moments you gotta deal with now. And so, what are the fixes then for the variance in the randomly specified model? If you gotta do this, the mean, you're getting the consistency. That was all done in the context of a GLM under univariate settings, but we've been essentially applying that under a continuous data model for correlated data. So we then switched focus to correlated continuous outcomes. By the way, if you're thinking about this here, I mean, I've got reading this down for you guys, but this would be kind of like Fitzmaurice, Laird, and Ware in chapter 10. That would be kind of a readable text. It's basically the first two chapters of Diggle, Liang, and Zager as well. You can also think about it as Nicole and Nelder, chapter 9. So those will be supplementary, and then the primary Diggle, Liang, and Zager chapters are all online. So now, for correlated continuous data, we thought about the general model setup. And really what I mean there is thinking about the dependence structure versus between clusters. And so, know the terminology, right? When I talk about an exchangeable correlation matrix, we need to know what that is in its relationship to a compound symmetric, which is the same thing. An autoregressive versus a continuous autoregressive process, a random intercept versus a random intercept and random slope process. Systematic component, again, I will argue the key thing about correlated data is you gain information on being able to estimate in time longitudinal effects, or you can think about within cluster effects, if you'd like to make that more general, versus cross-sectional effects, right? Which is where we had always been stuck in 210 and 211. We were always estimating cross-sectional effects. It was always talking about cross subpopulations. That's why I was always emphasizing that there. Now we can say, no, we can talk about what is the effect of age. But we can also talk about what is the effect of aging within a subject, right? And those are not necessarily the same thing. So you guys have been looking at that. Okay. Good. So again, going back to what I was saying before, common covariance structures that we entertain. Diagnostics for those covariance structures to help elucidate what's going on. For example, when to choose, right? So what I mean kind of by that is, Well, the most general of all covariant structures is an unstructured covariant structure. You're not going to go wrong there in terms of theoretically, it puts no assumptions on the covariant structure. But in practice, right? So when are you going to choose to use that? Well, I wouldn't say never necessarily, but balancing complete large numbers of independent clusters, small numbers of repeated measures within clusters. I mean, that's basically the bottom line. A lot of parameters, you got to be able to estimate them all. Okay, that's the bottom line. But, okay, Sebastian. All right, we're usually not that lucky to have everything that I just have talked about. Simulate this up. It's going to go erratic on you. It is not going to give you a reliable variance estimate at the end of the day. It's going to act horribly under imbalanced and incomplete data. I'm explicitly telling you guys that, but prove it to yourself. Simulate it under imbalanced and incomplete data. And see what you get. Okay?
So what do you do?
So, hold on one second, friends. I'll come back. All of these. Sans, in Ethan, I would argue the unstructured covariance matrix, because it does put assumptions on as well, right? What is the assumption the unstructured covariance?
It's
the same across all clusters, right? It doesn't change from one cluster to the next. That you're never going to be able to test because, well, you've only got one cluster of each one, right? So it's just less than one on each. But they're all simplifications of a very complex system. By the way, so are your mean models that you always fit as well. But now it's even worse, okay? Because it's much higher dimension. But what is the saving grace here? Well, there's that on the inference side, and then there's a second saving grace, I would argue. If I'm even close to it, reasonably close to it, what did we learn?
We get the efficiency if it appears close to it.
All right. I mean, I had you guys simulate data under a very strong autoregressive process, actually. And then what did I ask you to do? Treat it as if it was changeable. Assume it's the same across everything. Assume a common covariance. And how much efficiency did you get back? 95%. Pretty good. That's like you're horribly wrong, by the way. That's like I didn't even do anything. I'm just going to assume it's common and go to town with it, right? Okay. So just using something there. Now, you could go horribly, horribly, horribly wrong if you said, I'm going to assume it's independence. There you lost 50%. You probably don't want to do that. Okay. That should be reassuring to us, right, Hina? Okay, so now do something about it is my point here. Use some sort of weight, even if it's an average correlation. Okay, that's common across time that I'm willing to make an assumption about. So that gave us on the efficiency. Oh, there was another thing though. What about consistency and unbiasedness? Yeah, so if I've either got complete data, right, Sebastian, or if I've got missing completely at random data, it doesn't matter. Independence, sure, assume that. Weighted least square is going to get you back to an unbiased estimator. Exchangeable, sure, it'll get you back, right? Okay, but now if it's missing at random, not so much unless I've completely and correctly specified that missingness mechanism. And what that translated down to in the setting where I was showing you guys where you're dropping off because of your y values was that you had better be modeling your parents covering structure either correctly, but again, there was a little bit of a saving grace there. Under a strong autocorrelation structure, if you just fit kind of a common correlation, what happened to that bias? It was pretty much gone, right? I mean, it was, again, about 5% bias on just that simple 200 simulation study that I showed you, but that's generally true. Gain back something on it, okay? And you're gonna eliminate most of the bias there. So now we're talking about bias, we're talking about wins. The key thing, that the takeaway thing is, do an honest attempt at the EDA to try and come as close as you can. That's gonna help improve things as much as possible. But it's not really like all that's lost at the end of the day if you're not exact. And if it were, we should all go find new jobs, because that's not gonna happen in practice. Like, it's just not. You're not gonna be correct in your specification of that variance covariance structure. So those are kind of the guiding principles. And again, it all comes down to two moments on an estimator. What is the mean, and what is the variance? And then the final thing somebody said, it was, at the end of the day, I gotta do inference now. I was just now talking about the true mean, and I was talking about the true variance of that estimator when I'm talking about efficiency. The third component is, if I'm gonna do inference, I've gotta estimate the variance of that estimator. And then what's our fallback there? Roloff's variance estimator, we need it there. And so, yeah. It's a very pragmatic way of going about
This does anyone ever do some sort of data-driven sort of process where they modeling process where they first fit an autoregressive process and then a compound metric, and then they look at the empirical covariance and which sort of if you were to vectorize all of the code.
See how close you are.
Yeah, and see how close you are, and then pick the model that has the best one, just to be like, oh, this one should give me the best.
It's getting even closer. Yeah, people have actually advocated doing that in the literature. It's a reasonable approach as long as you're not kind of choosing, as long as your optimization criteria is getting as close to the robust variance estimator, the empirical variance estimator, as possible, and not inference on the point estimate.
Okay.
That's what people kind of run into. Let me just try a bunch of different weights. You can tell, yeah, until I show significance, quote unquote, on my predictor of interest. Again, going back to what we've learned, though, you don't gain generally a ton off of it. In other words, if I just tweak that thing a little bit, and so, you know, my sum of squared errors on the empirical versus model-based covariance goes from e to the minus 12 to e to the minus 7. That doesn't really gain you much on the efficiency. I mean, you saw already that you could be pretty far off and gain back 95% of the efficiency. So, you know, the key thing there is, I would say people are really most interested in saying, do I have enough independent samples to trust the empirical variance estimate? All right. So, yes, we'll go in order. So we started with Waverly squares, and we found out that very quickly it had to be an iterative process, right? Because if I've got this variance, covariance in there, what is the iteration that I need to go through? I have to estimate those variance components, which I'm going to do that based upon the model residuals. The model residuals are going to be a function of the betas in the systematic component, right? So each time I get a new estimate of those things, I'll get new residuals, I'll get a new estimate coming back on the variance covariance, and I round it off, basically, okay? So, but those estimates that we were getting for the variance components when I started with Waverly squares, Arseny, what type of estimates were we dealing with there?
Well, sure.
Somebody just said it for you. method of moments estimators, right? They weren't MLEs or anything else. They were very symbol-based moment estimators. Like if I wanted to estimate a common covariance, I would just take the product of adjacent residuals, right? For example, and then take the average of them. It's a method of moments-based estimators. Okay? What's the beauty of that? I'm guaranteed to get consistency out of those things, right? That's why we're doing it, right? It's like, okay, there means I get consistency out of these. Okay. And we were just having a conversation about this. But when you start talking about weighted least squares, what's the role of Gauss Markov there? And again, Gauss Markov is telling you that if you can get sigma inverse as your weight, you're good to go in terms of the best linear unbiased estimator. That's what Gauss Markov told you. Okay. So it's this concept of trying to gain back efficiency. Asymptotic distribution. In this case, it's kind of nice because you can literally write down the variance because it's just linear and wise. You can write it down, but it is, it follows directly. Again, you can kind of see the A inverse B A inverse by just simply taking the variance of beta hat W. You just get this big sandwich. And so, again, same point that we did before, it fixes the variance estimate. So these are what we would call, in the literature, marginal models and semi-parametric models, right? In other words, really there doesn't need to be a likelihood floating around. I never had to say anything about y being normal in those things. All I was doing was weighted least squares. All I was doing. Okay. So just coming at it and saying sum of squared residuals. And I want to weight those sum of squared residuals to get estimators. And we call them marginal models because they don't have random effects. They're not conditional upon a random effect when I was doing weighted least squares. Now there was one equivalent to a random effect model that gave rise to the same variance covariance structure, and that is if you took an exchangeable variance covariance structure, right, so a common covariance, that has an equivalence covariance structure to a random intercept common, right? Okay. So that's one tie-in that you have there. Okay. So taking it to the next step then, where you're saying, okay, now I want to rely upon a distribution. We could go to parametric estimation. And there, we're talking about random effects models. So now, if you notice, when I started that discussion, I said, assume yi vector is multivariate normal. Right? And it has these random effects, and they also follow a normal distribution. We're doing that because we need to now write down the likelihood. And I can start to maximize that likelihood.
One question.
Yes.
So if we can think about random effects,
yeah.
Up until this point, where was the Gauss symmetric structure coming from?
An assumption.
Okay.
I mean, it's basically a simple assumption. So it's also a common correlation. It's a very reasonable thing you might do.
Right. But in the model, what's the way to understand that kind of covariance structure? Wouldn't you just... I don't know. I've been thinking about random intercepts and exchangeable structure together.
Interchangeably?
Yeah.
That's because they give rise to the same thing.
Yeah.
And so you can think about an exchangeable correlation structure comes from people just having a latent trait that says that they tend to be high or low with respect to their mean relative to everyone else.
Mm-hmm.
And that latent trait means it's not changing as a function of time. Mm-hmm. So it's a common correlation no matter when I measure them. They always tend to be higher, or they always tend to be lower. Okay. So that is one way to think about it. Another way to simply think about it is that time doesn't matter, the distance between measurements on the time doesn't matter. I'm always going to have measurements that are similar to myself. It doesn't matter if I take them today, and then next week, or next year, or the next 10 years from now. So that's, again, what gives rise to an autoregressive structure. You should be asking yourself that same question, right? What model is giving rise to that? Not a continuous AR process, not an AR1 process. That has a specific name, right? A continuous AR process is that exponential process that says rho to the Tij minus Tik. And the answer is, it just feels good. No, I'm being honest with you. I'm being totally honest with you. It says measurements in time should have high correlation if they're close to one another, and it should dissipate. Is it likely to dissipate linearly? Well, it could, but probably not. It's probably going to start to drop off. And we start saying, that's a kind of a reasonable assumption to go with.
But you said that it also comes from the markers assumption, basically, right?
Not that exact parametric form, though. I mean, that's under a particular Markov model, right? I mean, again, that's a very specific parametric form of how correlation will drop off. So it does give rise from that first order model, right, where I said, when I derived it for you guys, and I said, if I regress yit on yit minus 1, that will give rise under very specific situations where I have common variance, and I've got this rho as the coefficient. That's really kind of a justification in the background of it, but it's exactly what Heen is doing with the random effect model, saying, okay, well, how can I justify from a model perspective? Oh, I can go to a random intercept. That gives me same rise, same thing. That's what I was doing. So, I mean, the key point is what if I had a random Markov model where it was y of t regressed on the log of y of t minus 1, or e to the y of t minus 1, or some other functional form of y of t would give rise to that same thing. So it's a very specific form. Yes.
So all we're doing in B,
yes,
all we did was, we did not change the B model, but we did change the random assumption.
Here. Relative to what?
Because you're changing your sigma.